Highland Park High School is a high school in the city of Los Angeles, California. It has 90 students, four teachers, a special needs department. It is a blank slate. It's the beginning of something that existed that we're trying to modify and help become the vibrant learning community that we're all seeking for our young people and for our world and our nation, obviously. I want to share with you two programs that are vibrant that we use on the campus that I've been involved in. This is called a palabra program. In Latin America, your palabra, your word, is your bond, word of honor, so to speak. And so it's a 16-week course in which young people, young men, develop the idea of the concept of being responsible, being the role model, and leading their family to a better day. So there's intense teachings that are Toltec, Mayan teachings from the past that are brought to the present about the bridge, for example, of adolescence, going from adolescence to manhood, and some of the things that we do to try to make our young men better young men than ever before. And it's very, very powerful. It changes discipline issues, if you want to call it that, and it helps young men express themselves. Also, we do another program here, and I'll show you this. This is the Clarity Program, and the Clarity Program is done with young ladies, and we're trying to clarify their lives through their eyes about all manner of things. Dating, husbands, mothers, families, decision making, just clarify so they make sound decisions in their future. Both of these programs are vibrant and have been very, very successful thanks to Richie Geisel and the Bienvenidos Family Service Center, Luis Ruan, who is the teacher of the Palabra program, and Jackie Reese, who is the teacher of the Clarity program. It's an environment where we're trying to change young people to the idea that they could be excited and running to school to learn that day what's going to happen in a myriad of ways. This, by the way, is a teacher's name. Mr. Metzger. He is our English teacher, and he has done great work with instruction, and we're adding to embellishing again that instruction by giving young people a chance to express themselves about, in this case, how they feel about him. And you can see, it's wonderful. To my right is another teacher's name. This is Mr. Upshaw. He's our science teacher, and it's leading to his classroom. And the young people wanted to give a feeling that they were entering into Mr. Upshaw's world, if you will, to learn science. So very, very exciting.
So we constantly find ourselves not only teaching subject matter, but also life skills, because the book is great, but there are other things that the book can't teach you about life. So I think we are able to expand our roles and expand our classes far beyond what we do in the book.
Kids here are different. They're all nice, respectful. We all have different personalities. We each have a story while we're here. Other schools' teachers just teach you the lesson on the board and then switch to the next subject. And here, we have the opportunity to work on that subject for a couple of days and we get right to it. We go home and work on them.
Our principal is a man. Unlike in other schools, you know, it's just some suit with a face. Our principal has an actual personality. You know, he gets to us. He gets through to most of the kids. It's different from any other school.
I got kicked out of my mom's house, and so, like, we had the Thanksgiving the lunch outside. I didn't have a Thanksgiving, but that day was my Thanksgiving, and basically everyone here is like my family, so I have them, even though I don't have my mom or my brothers.
It kind of showed us where we could be headed. It's kind of like, it's the crossroads school. Either we're going to end up screwed up or we're going to end up really well, and I think our principal's doing a really good job of that.
You look around, all the students are working on different classes. They come here at different places in their high school career. We enroll them continuously, and then we do our best to move them along almost entirely with individual instruction in the English program. The cool thing about our little school, since I'm the department, the English department, is that we can have tremendous flexibility. The English language is driven by skills, not so much knowledge. So there's not a body of knowledge they need to acquire. So they can use any topic that they're interested in to polish those skills, their communication skills, which is great.
We have begun an internship program, which is allowing young people to experience real-world learning at real-world sites during the school week, one day a week typically, where they're not on campus, they're in a learning environment somewhere relative to their interest hence the personalization piece, and it really sparks their creativity, their desire to learn, and their desire to go to that university level of education that we all know is so critical for the future of this country and our world and our children. This project has been 6 months for me, so to change the culture and climate of a school is a very delicate piece that requires some time. My previous assignment, it was a large school. We tried to make this kind of impact. We had some great, great successes, as evidenced by the D3 lab. I think credit should go to people who are philosophically in line with what we're doing. Elliot Washer from Big Picture Learning, Nancy Chow from the New Learning Institute, with Stephen Brown, and of course the teachers, Emily Pilenton, Project H nationally, are people that are trying to make this impact, the change in instruction, to get young people to begin to express themselves as they've never done before. And many of the young people that we've seen today would express that. They would tell you that the difference is people are listening. People are trying to find out who I am. It's kind of like, I'll use an analogy for a moment here. It's kind of like you take the drum and you begin to beat the drum. And you call them to the learning. It's like the sounding call the elders would use. There was a time in our land when dinner was served, the family would gather around the table. Father would stand, everyone would stand, and father would help mother sit down. Brothers would help sisters sit down, then we'd all sit down, and father would say a few words, and then we would break bread together. It created a world in which we had a high degree of moral value, a structure that was very healthy. We've lost it. We've lost it over time for a myriad of reasons. How do you create that in a school setting? How do you get a young person to see you as an elder, a leader, a person that they can rely upon to not be judgmental, but more, in fact, be focused on how do I help you learn better? I think as we move forward with this process of instruction in terms of engagement and personalization, it requires that we return to some of those values. Now, we can't obviously set up a dinner room table and sit around like that, even though we do those functions at this particular site. We do a Thanksgiving, a holiday feast, if you will, in a spring feast, and we sit together and we all eat together, and the teachers and students talk as they eat. Very, very healthy. And so to rekindle that love of learning that we've somehow have lost somewhere along the way, people are going to say, well, how do I do that? I'm at a school that has no money. I'm at a school that's urban or rural or whatever. It doesn't make any difference, because no matter where a school is, if you think about it, schools were designed and built around communities. Or should I say, the community built the school. Well, we need to bring that community back. So wherever you are, you could bring in artists, musicians, thinkers, speakers, families, fathers, mothers, daughters, to speak to young people about what's going on in their community and globally. So with that idea, with that thinking, imagine if our schools become what they really should be, second homes versus institutions that are driven by schedules and time constraints and suspension rates and attendance rates, such things. Of course, many would say those are very important things. They may well be, but if we bring in young people to a day when they can begin to hear that drumbeat, boom, 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 calling them to a love of learning, you're going to see young people running to school. You're going to see young people, there will be no suspensions, because they're going to be there learning. And most importantly of all, they're going to take that learning outside the school to the community and to the world. So, rekindle the love of learning through instruction, engagement, personalization, empowering young people to say, you know what, I want to learn and I want to do this. And then they can become the best ambassadors worldwide, globally, to help us at a time when we desperately need help. I don't need to state statistics or data, but we're all well aware of the danger schools are facing, both economically, philosophically, intellectually. I say, let's change instruction. Let's bring back that family-type learning, that personalization. Let me find out who you are, Joey, Susie, Betty, Tom, Bill, before I ask you to take an assignment and read a textbook and answer back in rote memorization, let me rather find out what is going on. What is your passion? What is your interest? I think when we do that, we're going to grab young people exactly where they are, and they're going to take that and say, I want to explode into the learning process. Fly high. Fly high. Because if you fly low and you're okay, what are you really in effect doing? You're allowing status quo to continue. We as educators have to understand that. I think a time has come where we must seek higher, right? And not the status quo. And if we do, we're going to create a better world for every one of us. So I hope you enjoyed this little snippet of learning, if you will. And that you can reach us at any time. Highland Park High School, Los Angeles, California. I am at your disposal at any time, anywhere, any place. And thank you so much for your attention during this process.